This is the new marbleized Noodler's ink piston filler. I'd like to demonstrate the clarity and crispness of the ink view windows. And also demonstrate the pen itself and tell you why it received the name that it did. This, for your information, it's number 41 brown. It's one of the most durable browns Noodler's has ever made, but the cost of the components has risen, and I refuse to increase the price of this ink for various reasons. Now, to fill, make sure this metal band at the section is covered in ink. That way there no air gets into the ink chamber. You want only ink to get into the ink chamber. This ink has a slight orange halo effect when used with a flex nib whenever it's wet. My apologies for being stubborn on prices, but once it's set, I am loath to increase it regardless of the reason. Rather discontinue than raise a price. The story of the color of this pen relates to two incidences. Both took place a while ago, when I was perhaps a bit younger and less cautious with life. Some of you might remember the Subic Bay Naval Base out in the Philippines. It was of prime importance to the U.S. fleet during operations in Vietnam. Some of you may also remember why it closed. It was a massive eruption. And you'll note here, I'm flexing a bit more than 2 to 3 ounces of pressure. Here I'm flexing just touching it on the surface. I don't have a light enough hand to do it, but I'll try to demonstrate it. If you do have a light hand, you can get a hairline out of this nib really fine, but you have to have a very light hand in order to make this line. With a heavy hand, you can literally make it as wide as if it were a calligraphy nib. And notice the flow of ink as I am flexing more is increasing. I didn't go fast. You can go too fast and the nib is not going to keep up with it. This nib and feed unit can deliver a lot of ink, but if you go too fast, any flex nib will eventually cause railroad tracks. The capillary action and cohesion won't be able to keep up with it. If I were to go that quickly, by about this point, you'd see railroad tracks. But going a more moderate speed, you can actually get a pretty dense, thick line, as well as this very fine hairline. The range is quite significant, and it doesn't take much to have the variation. I did that holding the end of the pen with moderate pressure. The reason for these wave marks, after Pinatubo erupted and Subic Bay Naval Base was shut down, the amount of ash and gases that were sent up into the atmosphere, it was massive. It wasn't quite as large as Krakatoa many years before, but it was big and it affected the climate. And off the coast of Massachusetts, we experienced pack ice. And It got pretty thick. It was approximately, in some areas, as thick as 2 feet. The further out to sea you went, it was about a foot and a half, but easily enough in certain instances to support an automobile. So skating was an easy proposition. However, pack ice, snow falls on it, and the process of driving out the salt from the salt water, it makes many aberrations in the ice, and it becomes bumpy. So if you skate across it, your jaw is going to hurt after a while from the shaking and the vibration. You're also going to trip, fall, hit aberrations, and they'll never permit you to go fast. After this climatic event, we had a fluke rainstorm. Lasted about 3 hours. The temperature went to 40, 45 degrees, and then quickly plunged back to 10, 5, single digits. This layer of new fresh water over the pack ice enabled amazing skating ability, and one could surf skate. It's something that was done in prior generations. Now, if you do it in broad daylight, you'll probably be reported. People in Massachusetts are not as free as they are in other states. So I wanted to try it out, and I went out there when there was moonlight, and no one would be likely to expect anybody to go out at night. And thus, I didn't expect to be reported, and I wasn't. As the waves hit the islands further out at sea, Nantucket and Martha's Vineyard, they would break up, and the energy would slow down, and the slope of the waves would decrease as it hit the pack ice. But the pack ice would still have gradual rises and falls. And this slope enabled a skater, if you waited for the crest, you could skate very quickly downslope towards the sea. At the crest, you could also skate downslope towards the land. And you would be able to skate at speeds of between 25 and 35 miles per hour. For a skater, that's pretty good, I think. And you were unobstructed as far as the eye could see. You could shut your eyes and just skate, and you would never hit anything. It was quite fun. The problem was I was having so much fun that on these downslopes I was consistently going out, testing it with an old iceman's pick on a very long pole for a semblance of safety. Of course, if you fell in, it's certain that you'd die. Hypothermia and the like, and certainly no chance of rescue, but as a free person, you are responsible for yourself, in my view, and can take such risks. It is not incumbent upon the state to stop you if you are a truly free individual. In any event, way out here, as I was approaching a halfway point towards one of the islands, I heard a marine mammal's tune. Now, you might think, well, isn't that nice? Moonlit night and clear, mirror-like glass, wonderful skating conditions, unique experience, unlikely to ever happen again. Before or since, it never has. It's tempting to think hearing a marine mammal is a good sign, but if you're on ice and a marine mammal has the potential to be big, and you've ever watched National Geographic specials, you know that marine mammals breathe air and that they breach. So I was going to get out of Dodge, and I started as quickly as possible to go back to shore. And that was the sum total of my fond memory of the effects of Mount Pinatubo on the coastal ice floes of Massachusetts. A little later, several years later, I went deep sea fishing, and we were trolling. We didn't chum, we had no gaff wounds, no hook wounds, no accidents, and it was determined that the heat was so bad that we could go swimming off the side of the boat. This, for 4 minutes, was okay, but at the end of about 4 minutes, there was a strange sensation that was going straight through me, and I found out through word of the captain that what I saw with my goggles, I thought perhaps this was a naval submarine and maybe we were in restricted territory. Perhaps we'd get in trouble. Perhaps the boat would come up to the surface. And that these very harsh clicks that were going straight through me was a ping or something coming from a submarine. Well, turned out these clicks, these clangs, they're from a whale. And the whale is basically seeing how thick your rib cage is, the size of your heart, what your fat content is, and in moments it's determined whether you're a friend or foe, and all sorts of information is likely going through the mind of the whale. We don't know that specifically. We don't know much about them, but what we do know is that their songs are distinctive, and the clicking is very distinctive to this particular species. And I got out of the water, and I unfortunately had shaded goggles on, but I could see the basic shape far, far below. And the thing that does to you, it makes you feel very small, and to realize that the ocean is truly massive, and that we are, as individuals, next to insignificant, and certainly in terms of size, and the experience is one that if you ever get the chance, now, given the Marine Mammals Protection Act, I probably violated something there, too. And I probably shouldn't even recommend it. But if you ever have the chance to swim in the presence of a sperm whale, and experience this going straight through you, I highly recommend it. It's a life-changing experience. As to the color of this pen, the darkness of the water under the ice and the white of the pack ice is part of why it is named what it is. But more importantly, this is a depiction of a white whale. Most sperm whales, from this point upwards, this is quite dark. Sometimes, particularly in deep water, this is almost black. From here down, in this area, you're looking at a whitening. And then, of course, they have their ivory teeth. The contrast between darkness and the white and the ivory is why this pen is called Ivory Darkness. And it's in honor of the two experiences where perhaps in this experience they saved me, because eventually pack ice stops existing and you go over the edge. And in this other instance, just the sheer majesty of Goliath, the Goliath of the deep, it's a stunning experience and is worth naming a pen after such a magnificent creature. That's it.